Good afternoon, folks. Oh, the rain stopped briefly, so I'm out. It's the usual pattern, isn't it? That's why you're getting videos once a fortnight. It's just raining and raining and raining and raining. And after this afternoon, we've got another week of it. So I thought I'd bring a bike out. To be honest, there are other reasons why you haven't had any videos. I made a post about that, health reasons. I'm not going to go on about that. During the rain this week, I sorted out my storage facility, the storage room in an old part of the house, and there was this one in there, and its mate. They were rather dusty, so I pulled them out, dusted them off, and I thought, well, I might as well pump the tyres up and give them both a burn, because it does them good. It does them no good to be sat. So here we are. We're just having a poodle round on each of two bikes. Have you guessed what it is yet? Of course. Those of you who follow the channel will know by now, this is the 1985 Raleigh Superbe, one of the very last of the Superbes, the proper ones. I took it in part exchange from Rob over in Doncaster 2 years ago now, maybe three. He took the Gazelle Special, the lovely green one with the rod operated drum brakes. So Rob has that bike. I took this in Partex. It was having problems with everything catching on everything else and the wheels not going around properly. It turns out it had a pair of cream Delta Cruisers on that had about 90 psi in them, and they were jamming everything. That was the main problem, but I gave it an overhaul anyway. There were a few issues with it, so I gave it all an overhaul on video. And that's way back down in the feed somewhere on the channel. I just stopped to contemplate my route. You can see there's just water everywhere at the moment. So really I need to stick to tarmac and not use the North Blackpool Pond Trail, which is my usual way home. So let's go and find somewhere dry to park up and chat about the bike for a minute. Oh. This is always a good place to come and sit quietly, which is one of my joys in life. Strange bod that I am, has always been to sit quietly. So you've seen this before. This is the site of the Burma Star Association Memorial. All those guys who went through hell. Anyone who's a holder of the Burma Star went through hell. And it's one of the places I come sometimes to sit quietly. So, what about the bike? Well, it's as it was. It hasn't been used since it was put away. So, I did it pretty much factory. Because it was a lovely original example. The state of the wheels, that's going to have to be hosed off when I get home, and maybe I'll find a nice clean puddle to go through on the way back. Yeah, I kept it as near factory as possible. because it was such a lovely original example. There's a couple of flaws on it. A bit of polish there that I'm just taking off as well. There we are. There we have a little cauliflower there. And it's a shame because it's the only one really. It's got not all but quite a lot of the original pinstriping. If you use T-cut or any kind of heavy polishing on that, it just wipes straight off. So it's nice to have plenty of that still on. Oh, it's a bit of the dust, look. I did it in a hurry, cleaning it off to come out. So there's still a bit of dust around there. So in there is the one modification from standard. It's got the sensible sauntering sprocket, as my pal Jeff called it. It's the 22 tooth Sturmey Archer sprocket instead of the original 18, and it makes the gearing so much more usable. It was just too high before, too Dutch, because this model was mostly intended for the continental market, Netherlands, Belgium, etc. This particular one is a British dealer version. We're finding out more and more through with the Raleigh Superbe Owners Club group. We're all pooling knowledge between ourselves and our colleagues on the mainland as well about this last hurrah of the Superbe, which was the Dutch models, as we call them. Not strictly accurate, because the maroon version of this, the rare one, seemed to be almost all Belgium. The green ones, almost all Netherlands. But the true export ones didn't have a dyno hub. They had a bottle dynamo because that was their regulations at the time. But these still have a continental style rear light. But even that was changed later to one incorporating a stand light, as regulations changed on the mainland. So we call them the Dutch models, but it's not strictly true. In the mid-70s, Raleigh revived the Superbe name, which had been used to designate a deluxe model of each, a deluxe version of each model. So there was the Dawn Tourist and the Superbe Dawn Tourist, the Sports Tourist and the Superbe Sports Tourist. The Superbe always had stainless steel wheels, and it had four speeds and a fork lock. Some of those things were sometimes found on some other models. It was all very confusing. But the Superbe was never badged, not after about the 1920s. In the 20s there were a few that had model Superbe on the top there, or maybe down there. But certainly post-war, they were never designated the Superbe. They were just the old green Raleigh. In the mid-70s, Raleigh relaunched it by popular demand, mostly from the dealers, whose customers were asking for them. And they badged it as a Superbe, but it had rod brakes for the nostalgia factor again. But they decided to keep the price down by putting lower quality chrome steel wheels in. It was three speed by then because the four speed had stopped being produced. It still had the dyno hub and the lights and the fork lock, but the quality was not quite there. It didn't have a carrier either. It was when they tried selling them on the continent, and the European dealers just said no, that they realised they had to up the game, and probably consultation with the Raleigh importers in the different countries as well. They will have laid out what they required. So Raleigh went back to the design department and came up with this. Not quite a jump into this, bit of an evolution. There's a couple of crossover models. You can tell these later models at a glance by the alloy cranks. That was a major move over to a square taper bottom bracket with alloy Raleigh branded cranks. Sometimes another brand of cranks were fitted as well, the one called Custom that used to get on there. So if you see one that's got a different type of alloy crank, it's not necessarily the case that it's not original. And they put stainless steel rims back on. sometimes stainless steel spokes, sometimes not in this case. And at one point the headlamp moved from there down to here. Again, that'll be something to do with regulations in one of the countries. The pump moved up to the top tube just before this model came out, and they have the later type of mud guards with the flat top, not the trouser crease. So that's your late model. Oh, and they had this built-in rather nice color-coded carrier. That's your late model Superbe. Sorry for those who know it all already. About 5 years ago I made a video on identifying the different Superbe models, and it needs to be remade. That was my knowledge and my friend Peter's knowledge at the time. A lot's happened since then. The Owners Club group on Facebook has led to a great pooling of knowledge and an increase in the general enthusiasm for these models, really. They're still being pulled out of cellars and skips and garages. You can still pick them up at the tip if you're in the right place at the right time. But one like this now, where it would have been 80 quid 5 years ago, is now 250. So they are going up. Anyway, this bike, yeah, I've ridden it around today. It's absolutely lovely and silent and everything is working perfectly, I'm glad to report. Rob will be glad to know. Since I took this as well, I got in a Gazelle Maxinette, which is a small Gazelle. And Rob's partner, Helen, wants that. So that's in the queue after these rallies and Mr. Hudson to get done. It's sat there for more than long enough. I need to build wheels for it and stuff, so it kind of, you know, it gets pushed to the back. And then the Maxinette is going back to join the Green Gazelle with Rob, and he's having this back. So that's nice. It's going back to someone who loves it and knows it. That's good news, because I can't keep them all. They're eating space. One thing I need to do to it, you've probably noticed, I sourced a new old stock D-piece, a few of them, and they came in black, so I just need to give that a squirt of green. And now I need to go back and give it a little clean. Was it worth getting it dirty? You betcha. Factory bell there, folks. Factory pedals. The ugly, ugly factory mud flap. The luggage elastics, which came as standard and always lose their bounce, and that's why that one's wrapped around at the back and tucked under. The handlebars are somewhere between a North Road and an All Rounder, known as a North Rounder. Not my ideal, but I can see why they fitted them. So it wasn't too old-fashioned, but in the context of the day, they didn't want it to look too much like a granddad bike. These grips, again, factory. Horrible, don't like them at all. I just don't like this ribbed texture. Great in the wet. Excellent for use in the wet, because the water goes into the channels and you've still got a gripping surface on top, your hand doesn't slip off. They've probably been tested to that effect and specified accordingly. I just don't like it. Oh yeah, and we've got one of these. I'll just show you this before we go on. There, you see, that's how it works. Underneath here there are 1, 2, 3 little indentations. And you can choose your indentation, choose your position for your handlebars, wiggle, wiggle, put that in. Trying to do it one-handed. There we are, that's gone in now. And now that steering is locked. And unlocked again. And quite rightly, there's a notice. Cycle must not be ridden with key in lock. It's in the lock so I don't lose it. It won't come out like that either. It is kind of locked in. And I don't want to lose it. They say that so that it doesn't get accidentally turned while you're riding. Well, I've got the wheels dirty now, so I'm less bothered. I'll give it a nice clean when I get it home. It's what it deserves. It definitely has been worth it, because Not only have I had a nice ride out on a Superbe, but I've remembered what a lovely bike this is. Remembered how nice a standard late model Superbe is to ride, and remembered what a cracking example this one is. Have you spotted one other thing that needs doing? That should have a rubbery plasticky cover over it, a soft cover. So that's two jobs to do: paint the DP screen and change the shifter, or put a cover on. And now there's a dynamo wire touching the spokes. You hear it? One thing about the chain case. Chain cases are great things, but they are sound boxes like a musical instrument. They really do amplify everything. Right, concentration required here. I wasn't going to tempt fate by trying to record that. We're on a semi-hard surface now. We are back on the North Blackpool Pond Trail. I think we might be coming for a walk along here in a bit. It's a big one. Hello. Bird watcher, probably not wanting to make a noise. Here we are, regular viewers will know this as the beginning and end of most of my rides that go from home. Up the semi-steep little lane. That 22 tooth sprocket does work, it makes first gear a reasonable hill climbing gear, and it makes third gear a nice cruising gear. With the standard gearing, I find that third gear is only useful for going down hills where I rode freewheel anyway. So there we are. Thoroughly enjoyed that. Now we've got to do some cleaning. But this isn't all I've been doing today. Stay tuned. After the break... No. Just stay tuned. See you in a minute. Yes, it's changed colour. Of course I had to get its mate out, didn't I? This is a Belgian model in the much harder to find maroon. Now, this is a bike that I took in on behalf of Chris Lawrence, who is one of the co-admins of the Raleigh Superbe Owners Club. And Chris had found this bike. He said, "What do you think?" I looked at the advert. I said, "I know that postcode." And it was Al's place, Al of the collection. And I realised that this was a bike that Al had offered me, and I hadn't been able to afford it at the time. And it wasn't in this condition. This has been done by my own fair hands. And so I went down to Al's to collect it on Chris's behalf and renovate it on Chris's behalf. While I was there, I came home with the large Elizabethan and the Boulevard Tourist. So that was the first batch of bikes I got from Al's. And then, of course, earlier this year, late last year, in fact, some of the local antisocials, or it might be the farm lads from up the back, tending to those horses, could be them. Anyway, in the second batch of bikes, Al was also disposing of the absolutely fantastic conditioned ex-British Embassy in Brussels version of this, and I missed it. I was just too late. Then, delighted to find it went to another co-admin of the Raleigh Superbe Owners Club, so we've all got bikes from that collection. Anyway, back to this bike. It's a Belgian model. It was actually a Belgian model, and unfortunately no dealer sticker, but it has the telltales such as this. There's a little boss on the inside of the forks here. Couriers have that as well, and I've seen it occasionally on travellers. So if you have a 80s rally roadster with a little screwed boss on the inside of there, like so, that's what it's for. It's for a dynamo on bikes without dyno hubs. Now, there was some speculation that it's because the AG 3-speed with dynamo hub had ceased production. That wasn't the case, because they were still making Superbes with dyno hubs after this. This is a late 84, so spec is the same as the other one. This has a pair of different non-rally branded cranks on, but they are original. These pedals, I'm not sure about these. Chris supplied these for the renovation. I still think it should have some like the other bike has. Chris, if you want to get back to me, do you want these or do you want the other type? I have both. As you can see, a little bit more of the lining has disappeared on this one, and a couple of the transfers are looking sad. That needs a new transfer on there. I think he's got a new one for when I deliver it to him. So again, I renovated it as much to factory as I could, and it's been in storage since. The observant will also notice that the headlamp is in the higher position. It did have a vinyl mattress saddle on, but that's been remedied with a B66 like it should have had all along. These bikes all have the alloy Vaneman calipers, which is my excuse to upgrade rally roadsters that have the steel plate ones to these, because they're just nicer, they're better, apart from being lighter, because lightness is so important on a bike like this. Standard gearing on this one as well, so I've noticed the difference in my round the block this far. But now I'm going to take it for a little bit more of a shakedown and bring you with me on what is left of the battery. So that gives you an idea of the difference in gearing with the standard. That's in first gear, which I've used most of the way here on flat riding. So why keep the standard gearing? Well, quite simply, it's going to Chris, and Chris has quite a few. And this particular one, he wanted to experience the factory ride. And get that, it's nice to have one that's completely standard, so you can just now and again experience what it was like to ride one fresh from the box. Exactly factory spec. And the feeling is marvellous, exactly like the green one. It's got the same handlebars, same stem, same grips, all the lovely goodness. But I don't like the gearing. I would definitely gear it down if it was mine. Notice this one's got a white tail, the other one didn't. That's my white tail. The mud guards actually were changed. The other ones were pretty horrid. So Chris sent me a set of mud guards that he got, and I think he'd got them as almost new old stock maroon Superbe mud guards, and they weren't. They were a pair of fairly tatty cameo mud guards. So I restored them, and here they are on here now. And because it's from the Low Countries, I gave it a white tail. It's going to get a heron on there. Chris has one. What it could do with is a maroon pump for under the top tube there. Good luck with that. Somebody's shed in Belgium, maybe. If you think that looks a bit tarnished, it's not. It's actually got a yellow bulb in there. France and Belgium back in the day required yellow headlamp bulbs in all vehicles, including bicycles. Do you remember back in the day when British people went to France, we had to put amber sort of yellow covers over our headlamps? Or if you were posh, you put yellow bulbs in. It meant you were posh because it meant you went to France regularly. But we still had to put some beam deflectors on for our dip beams, so that our dip beams would go that way instead of that way. Still do have to do that. But not the yellow bulbs anymore. And of course, you probably know I love old French cars. And it's something I do. It's a little affectation, a little nonsense that I do. I always put yellow bulbs in on the old Citroëns. Dear, dear, dear. Another one for the wash. Oh, I'm going to mosey back now and wash these two bikes and put this video together, and that I think will be it for the weather. Remember a little while ago when I came out, there's quite a lot of blue sky. Yep, it's coming in. I think it's time I got back. I'm about a mile and a half from home now, so time I got back. Thanks for coming along. Little inconsequential video, not making any progress in the workshop. To be honest, every time I go in there and look at the workstand and the tripod, it's just been a bit of a mental block of late, because of other ongoing health issues. I've just not felt like it. So I've been meaning to. And then something else is happening this week, bike-wise, fleet-wise. So I'll put a video out when that happens, and until then, keep riding, stay safe, enjoy your bikes, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye now. Still first gear, look. Ridiculous.